Okay, well, hello everybody. Thanks for being here today. My name is Remy Leon. I'm an alumni of the Lynx. It's a great pleasure for me to be back with you to present you Container 101. So it's a presentation about what are the containers exactly. You may be already a little bit familiar with Docker and so on. But today I would like to go through the fundamentals of what exactly is a container, why is it important, and why you should care. So as an overview, we will go a first time about what is a container exactly, what are the problems that a container solves, how you can get started today if it's not already the case. And then I will go in detail about the compute, storage, and networking aspect of container and containerization. So it will be a very short presentation compared to the amount of stuff that I would like to tell you. So don't hesitate to take questions at the end of the talk, where we can maybe share and I can maybe answer the question that you got about your specific use cases. So container. So you might be familiar with container. You hear this term a lot, but you might wonder, why are we talking about container in computer science? Well, mostly it comes from the shipping industry. So you might be familiar with containers that are on a port or that are being moved around with trucks and so on. So this name of container was not chosen by mistake. It's a precise description of what we intend to do with container in computer science. And you might also hear a lot of aquatic term for the industry of containerization. So it's not a mistake. It comes from that. So let's move on and talk about what is a container. So a container have several aspects. First, it's portable. So it means that you can move a container from one place to another, and it can be transported on a various amount of ships. It can be transported on trucks. It can be transported even on plane. It's a standard size. And because it's a standard size, boats can be built on top of specification that allows them to host as many containers as they can. You can have a wide variety of cargo packed inside a single container. What it means that if you are moving iPhones or bananas, you can move bananas and iPhone in separate containers. You don't need to have them inside the same one. You can isolate them. And that's a key aspect that you have to understand about containers. They are an isolation mechanism. Because they are of standard size, it means that you can run them anywhere. And you can put several containers on a single ship. So for instance, in large boats, you can have thousands of containers that are packed on the same ship. And the cargo, therefore, are isolated from each other. It means that if you have bananas and iPhone, iPhone don't go inside the bananas and the banana don't go inside iPhone. That's the core aspect of what is a container. In software, it's exactly the same. You want to have your software that can be portable, that you can run in a various amount of environment. You want to be able to run them on Windows, on Linux, on Mac, for instance. You want to pack a wide variety of software inside this isolation mechanism. So it means, for instance, if Fabien is working with Java and Francois is working with Python and Marco is working with C, they want to be able to communicate and interact with each other without paying attention to the special dependencies installed on the host. They want to pack all their dependencies inside the container. And once they have the container, they run it and it's done. They want it to be a standard format. And that's a key aspect. In particular, you can have many containers on a physical node. If I take the example of Google, for instance, on a single machine, on a single hypervisor, you can have thousands of containers running in parallel. Because containers can be created very fast and can be deleted very fast as well. But what I want to give to you is that a container is an isolation mechanism. It's an isolation of your application in regard of the host. So what exactly is a container? So you can have a large amount of different description about what is a container, and I will go a little bit inside the detail without digging too deep. But the key aspect to understand is that you pack the code and the dependency together. It means that the container is agnostic. It doesn't have any memory. Once the container is over, when the container returns, all its non-persisted storage is gone as well. So you want to pack the dependency and the code together. In particular, once you have this format, you can run this image anywhere. Anywhere that container runtime is running, you can run your container. That's it. And the key aspect to understand is that you can execute multiple containers on a single physical machine. That's also the key reason why the cloud industry cares so much about container. And there I'm going a little bit off track of the presentation and going more into the economics of clouds. But mostly a cloud provider is like a flight company or a truck company or a train company. Basically, they only make money when they can rent services. And if you have idle resources on a physical machine, it's money in waiting to be made. So in order to reuse as much physical resources as they possibly can, they want to have a fine-grained isolation of application. And it's way better to isolate a container rather than to isolate a virtual machine. Therefore, that's also one, there is a virtuous cycle of innovation in the cloud industry, because the cloud computing provider wants to reuse as much physical hardware as possible, and the user wants to have a workflow that is as flexible as possible, where they can run in any cloud in any cloud provider that they want. So there is an economic aspect that is virtuous in this situation that makes this technology move forward. Maybe you have already heard about virtual machine, and virtual machine sounds a little bit familiar with container, because in a virtual machine, you have an operating system and the software packed together inside a single stuff that can run anywhere where an hypervisor runs. So it rhymes a little bit with container, and you can also have multiple VM on a single physical machine. So it looks similar. So what are the differences? Well, a VM works with a software that is called an hypervisor. So there is different kind of hypervisor. You have Hyper-V, you have Xen, you have a multiple of brand of hypervisor. But basically, the principle is always the same. You have a kernel, that is the kernel of the hypervisor. You have a layer between the different VM, and the hypervisor will emulate system calls from the VM. And therefore, when you have a VM, you pay for the overhead of the operating system that you're trying to emulate, and you pay for the overhead of the hypervisor by itself. So you pay for multiple layers of indirection that make VM very isolated from each other, but they are a little bit effective. On one CPU, you are going to spend maybe, I don't know, 10%, 20% on the pure overhead and on the pure context switch. Containers, on the other hand, are isolation mechanism that is living at the kernel layer. So because you are forced to have a kernel in any situation when you run a machine, you reuse the same kernel across all the different containers. So you pay for the kernel only once. And you have the isolation mechanism that is provided by the kernel. And therefore, that's also one of the reasons why containers are so fast to start and so fast to stop, because they don't emulate a complete operating system. They are simply a process that is isolated. And because you reuse the same kernel across all the different containers, well, you can have a little bit of a performance boost compared to what you would have with a VM. So, VM and container are not opposed to each other. It's possible for certain situations to only use VM. For instance, if you want to run a Windows operating system on a Linux machine, it's only possible through VM. You cannot emulate a Windows in a container. That's not possible, actually. And sometimes you have software that is too old, that won't be reworked on, and sometimes the VM is your best shot. But in case you are with software that is young enough, that can be worked on enough, container can be a really, really interesting opportunity. Why? Because they allow you to have a more modular system of delivering software. If you have a monolith application where you have all your application and all your dependency bundled inside a big pack, well, when you want to deliver, when you want to release this software, you are kind of forced to do it all in once. And therefore, if you have a system with a bunch of dependencies, you are forced to take into account that all the dependencies are working well with each other. While when you are working with microservices, you have a much more fine-grained quantum of deployment, and therefore you can take much more, targeted approach for releasing specific piece of software that will be independent from each other. You are not dependent on a huge blob of monoliths that you will push in one side. Bonjour. So one thing that I want to make you understand is that containers are not new. They have existed for a very long time. In the beginning of computer science in the 70s, you had the same problematic. You wanted to share physical resources across different users, and you want them to be isolated from each other. And the problem is that if one user in this situation was doing some mistake, it could impact another person that is also working on the same software. So the need for containers was present from the early age. It's basically, how can I isolate that person A and person B will not mess with each other? And there have been a bunch of technologies that existed. And Docker, if you have heard of it, is only one brand of a technology that came out recently. But the premise, the fundamental premises in operating system-wise existed for a very long time. And so don't think that containers are something new. Virtualization of processes and isolation of processes is something that we have done for a very long time. And Docker is just a good brand. They have found a good marketing strategy to package all those technology and make them easy to use for developers. But the fundamentals have been there for a very, very long time. And for instance, if you look on the Linux kernel website, you will not find the container world anywhere. You will find C groups, you will find namespaces, but the kernel don't care about Docker. Docker is just a brand that built on top of fundamentals that have been there for a very long time. So the key idea that I want to make you to understand is that container has a are an isolation mechanism, that they allow you to have standard deployment, and they allow you to have better resource efficiency. So I'm going to make a pause right here because it's a lot of information to digest. Is it clear for everybody, or do you have questions?
What are the benefits of Docker compared to Shroud?
There is a bunch. Chroot with, alors, it's going to get technical, but chroot is only changing the root of a given process, but it will not manage network isolation. It will not manage volume presentation. It will not manage the image workflow. So how do I package processes? How do I commit the state of a given processes? All those states are not managed by chroot. Chroot will only change the root of the file system of a given process, but it will not manage all the other aspects.
Yes, but you told that when you use Docker, you share the same kernel.
Yeah.
And so the network calls, the system calls, etc., are managed by the same kernel.
Yeah.
So how Docker could isolate this if you use the same kernel?
They can do it using C groups. So C groups are the fundamental technology that is available inside the Linux kernel. And there is several talks on YouTube where they show you how to you can create your own kernel without Docker, but using only standard Linux kernel fundamentals such as C group. And you have LXC also, that is also a layer of technology that is way lower than Docker. Docker is something that is built on top and that is more easy to manage for developers, but the isolation of network calls, the isolation of IO calls, the isolation of the processes, the restriction of CPU time that you can have on a given container, all of this is managed by cgroups. Docker, okay, at the end of the day, is only manipulating cgroups for you.
And so if I summarize, so you have so this used probably chroot to provide file system isolation, cgroup, yeah, network and CPU isolation.
Yeah.
And that use other former components or that's all?
There is all the aspect of image distribution that is quite useful. So how do you start a given image? How do you package a certain image? How do you transmit it to a register? How you can fetch a given image? all of this is not managed per se by the kernel. It's mostly like a developer workflow. So the kernel don't care too much about that. So you would need, if you wanted to recreate Docker, you would need to have a specific tools for how I can build image locally, push them and pull them.
Okay. It's not just packaging chroot and cgroup. You have this image management additionally to this.
Yeah. And this you have a specific command for this.
Okay.
So this is the added value because usually you have a register where you store all the images. You can share them. You can have access control about who can access a given images or not. And once you pull an image, you pull all the dependency. But the kernel don't care. The kernel will start processes whenever you tell him to go, but it will not manage the image workflow for you.
Okay.
Any other question?
I have a small question on a
status. Yeah.
So how do how is there the communication between the devices? I mean, between the containers, is there a specific format that the data is exchanged, or you see what I mean? Docker one does a job, Docker two does another job. There is an exchange of information between them. How is this information taking place?
I'm going to reformulate your question. Is your question about how I can have information exchanges between different containers?
This is the question, and also the type of how is there a specific
So there is different kind of information exchanges that can take place. The first one that I can think about is network calls. So you can have network calls from container A to container B, or from container A to the outside world. So all of this is happening through different network possibility offered by a container runtime. But usually, you will have an isolation of the container. The container will have an ETH0 that is popping up. And there will be on a single bridge. So all the container will share the same bridge. I will go through all these details in a later section of this presentation, talking about the network aspect. And there is also a storage aspect. So you can store information and read information from a previously stored information. And I will go through all these details inside the storage presentation, in the storage section of this presentation. So I will come to this question later on.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Is there other questions?
I have a question on the volume.
Yeah.
Is it a share root which manage volume for?
I will go through that inside the storage section of the presentation.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Thanks. But about container fundamental, is there other questions? I would say no. So let's move on. Don't worry. I will come back to this aspect. So how you can set up Docker today? Well, you can, when I say Docker, you can think of it like Kleenex. So Kleenex is a brand of container. Container are the real innovation, and Docker is a company founded by very nice people, one of which that I like very much, but it's only a brand. It's a brand like Kleenex or Frigo or all of this. The real aspect is container. So don't think that Docker is forever and that's a technology that will survive for a very long time. But the key aspect is that it's a brand. So how you can get started with container today? Well, Docker is a nice option. And you can go on docker.com with the option of getting Docker. So on Google, you can get on that very quickly. If you are on a Windows machine, I will strongly advise you to enable Windows Sub Linux System 2. That is a very useful piece of software that will allow you to have near native performances on your Linux machine working on Windows. So this is very useful. I will strongly advise you to enable that to have very good performances. If you are on a Mac, you will not have native emulation of Linux call, unfortunately, because Mac does not support it. But you can have Docker for Mac that allow you to have a small virtual machine that is launched inside Mac that will be emulated as a virtual machine. And then inside this Linux virtual machine, you will have your container runtime that is working there, because Mac doesn't allow for other stuff. So at the moment, if you have a Mac, Docker for Mac is your best option. If you are on Linux, all is natively supported. So you have all the native calls, the kernel is native, you have no performances overhead. And I want to invite you to take into account that GPU are supported, in particular NVIDIA through CUDA is supported. So you can have CUDA software that is running inside the container. So pay attention to that. It can be useful for deep learning scenario and so on. Let's talk about the
okay, interruption. Vercel is a Docker client for Windows, a desktop client. So yep. You recommend not to use it and directly go through the
It changed a lot. This technology changed a lot and the performances change a lot from one version to another. So don't think that it's stable and going through the end of time. But Docker for Windows, last I checked, was a very good option. But if they have a native option for Docker, you can maybe check it out. But the key aspect that you have to understand is that the Windows sub Linux 2 is the investment that Microsoft have done to have a Linux kernel working natively on Windows. And there is rumor that in the future version, the Linux kernel could be the kernel of Windows, period. That Windows NT, so the current kernel of Windows, could be deprecated, and that all the rest will be done with emulation of Linux. So this could happen. Linux could become the kernel of Windows. This could happen. Let's talk about when you install Docker, what do you install actually on your machine? So what is exactly happening? When you are running Docker, usually you have a Docker host. So it's a Docker daemon that will be a server that will be receiving calls from client. So when you do a Docker build, Docker pull, Docker run, you are using a client to send a request to a server that is running locally on your machine. The Docker daemon is in charge of managing several stuff, but it's mostly in charge of managing images that is not managed by your kernel natively. So the bunch of data. So if I want to run Ubuntu, or if I want to run a PostgreSQL, or if I want to run a MySQL, the image and the sharing of images is done by the Docker daemon. And once I got the image in, I can start container. You can see container as instances of the images. I will come back to that later on. In particular, the Docker daemon will be also in charge of pushing and pulling from external registry. So if I got images that I've been working on locally and I want to push them to share them with my friends, I can push them to the registry and the Docker daemon will manage all these exchanges and authentication and so on. So this is a big picture. When you are doing a Docker command, the client send a request to a server running locally and that will do stuff on your behalf. Let's talk now about the compute aspect. So I will have a compute section, a storage section, and a network section. All of this will present different aspects of containers. So a Docker container, what is it exactly? It's where the computation happens. When you run a process, when you use CPU to compute some stuff, it will happen always inside a container. And by the way, if you are using Linux distribution aujourd'hui, today with systemd and this kind of technology, you are already using C groups without knowing it. So you are using container today, even without knowing it, if you are using a Linux distribution today with systemd. So the container is a set of running processes. So the same processes that you probably know if you have done a little bit of operating system. And they are isolated from each other using Linux kernel C groups construct. The container are stateless. So it means that if you kill a container and you restart it, you have lost all your state that is not persisted. It can be interactive or non-interactive. You can connect to one container. You can disconnect from one container. You can start new processes inside the container and so on. But the key aspect to understand is that the computation will happen inside the container. When you run Docker container, you will have a bunch of commands that show up. You don't need to memorize all of them. The key aspect that you have to understand is that all those verbs are related to a container resource. When I attach to a container, when I commit a container, when I pose a container, when I start a container, it's always a verb that I apply on a given resource, on a container. The container is about running computation. Is that clear for the container aspect? So the container is where the compute will happen. I can show, I can would show you demo, but it will cut the flow, and I have already a lot of stuff to present. But if you are lost with what can I do with a container, just type Docker container, and you will have a summary of all the verb that you can apply on a given container. Now let's talk about the storage. So as I said previously, the container are without memory. When you kill them, you lost all the state that was inside it. So how do you persist information? How do you move an image from one state to another? How do you pack your stuff inside the container? Well, you do it using images. So images are a really interesting piece of software. It's the way that you are going to manage your dependency. For instance, let's suppose that you have a Python software that you want to run. You will probably have to install a bunch of dependency. Same if you use Ruby, C, Java, any other software, most of the time you will have dependencies. Those dependencies will be packed inside layers. So an image is a bunch of layers that are stacked on top of each other. So images can have tags, version, and metadata. You can say, Fabien created this image. The email of Fabien is this. You can pack a bunch of metadata on top of an image. But deeply, an image, what is it? It's a bunch of layers that are read-only. So when you pack something inside a layer, it will stay there and it's committed. You will not be able to touch it without adding another layer. So you can see the image kind of like a blueprint. For instance, when you are inside an oriented programming language, you have classes and instance. Well, you can see the class as Docker Imagine, and you can see the instance as a container. This is something helpful to keep in mind. And so in particular, when you are doing a system call inside your container, for instance, you want to write a file, you will have it inside a tiny read and write layer that is the container layer that is on top. And in particular, if the container die, this layer, if it's not committed, will die also. So all the change will happen on this particular layer. And all the rest are committed and read-only. You cannot touch them. So how do I build an image? You build it using a Docker file. If you have already seen a repository with a Docker file, you can see this file as a recipe for building the image that I've seen in the previous slide. So a Docker file is basically a small language that will tell you, I want to add this file. I want to run this command. I want to run this command. I want to add this file. That's it. My image is done. Commit this. And you will, and Docker will build this image for you and make it available for you. You can also have multiple stages in order to avoid having heavy weight images. For instance, let's suppose that you have a big Java application with tons and tons and tons of dependencies that are only required only for building, but not for running. You need these dependencies, but you don't want to have an image that is 2 gigabytes large because it's huge. Therefore, what you do, you can have a multi-stage build. So in one stage, you will have all the dependencies that are required. You will build your stuff, and then you will transfer the artifacts that you build in this stage to another stage that is only limited to the artifacts that you built. And after you ditch the build layer, and by doing so, you will have a lightweight image that is only containing the stuff that you want and not all the dependencies that have been required for building it. So I'm also giving you a lot of keywords like this, multi-stage build with Dockerfile. This will help you in case you have big images. And finally, when I got an image, what can I do with it? Well, you can share it with your friends using registries. So registries are a place where you can share images and pull them to bring them on your local Docker runtime. So this registry can be local. When you have a Docker for Windows or a Docker for Mac, you have a local registry running inside your laptop. But you can also have a public one. So up.docker.com is a registry that you can use for free, where you can push images and bring them back to you. You can have private registries where you store like the software of your company that you don't want necessarily to share openly on the world. And so you pay a price to have this registry. By the way, Scaleway offers this kind of registry if you're interested. They are very useful in CI/CD setup. So what is CI/CD? It's for continuous integration, continuous delivery. When you are doing software updates, when you are moving your software along, sometimes you want to release version into the wild and you don't want to do this by hand. So usually you tag a given version of your software and then you have a complete pipeline that will build your artifact, move them along and make them available for your registry. And this is the CI/CD setup, grossly. And a part of this process, a part of this pipeline could be pushing images to an image registry. That could be public or private. Yeah.
I have a question, but maybe it contradicts the notion of isolation. I was wondering if it was possible to share some layers across various images. No, not images. Say virtual machines, containers, sorry. It's possible, for example, you took the example of big Java programs.
Yeah.
For example, to imagine that two containers requiring Java share the same GRE, for example.
Yeah, it's completely possible. I talked about it a little bit later on, but it's used copy on write, and I'm going to explain what it is about. But yeah, okay. It's completely possible.
But you could do this. Okay. But the underlying OS, for instance, you may not want to ship an Ubuntu in every image of the Docker back on the machine.
Yeah.
So they can share the same Ubuntu, for instance?
They can share the same layer, and then after only do specific operation when they want to modify something. So you can reuse the same layer for Ubuntu across several containers. That's actually what is done in most cases. And in particular, there is operating systems that are dedicated for container. For instance, Alpine, that is a distribution that is 3 megabytes. So you can have a complete Linux operating system for 3 megabytes. There is a specific package manager that is very small, but you can use that to have as little overhead as possible and not having the brand names such as Debian or Ubuntu that are present on the container space, but have images that are a little bit bigger, but you get a little bit more tooling, so it's as you prefer. But I will come back after for the reusing. So in case you're lost and you don't know what you can do with an image, just tap Docker image, and you will have a bunch of commands that show up and that will tell you what you can do with an image. But you can push it, you can pull it, you can remove one, you can do a bunch of stuff. But the key aspect is that all those verbs are related to a single image resource. So that's why also I spent some time on the fundamentals, because the verb and the specific action you can guess on your own. But if the fundamentals are right in place, it's way easier.
Dockerfile,
yeah.
Is it YAML or is it something else?
Dockerfile is a specific language with a verb and something that comes after. So it's usually add, copy, but it's a very simple language. It's only verb that you put one after the other. And once you are done with it, the image is done. So there is several words. So there is like, 30 or 40 verbs, but you mostly use add, copy, run. So the one that you will reuse all the time are very well understood. And after, it's only commands that you will run inside the machine. So it's very easy to understand. So now I can talk about volume. And in particular, if there is no state inside the container, how can I persist stuff across different containers? In particular, if images are static and the container are stateless, how do you manage the data persistence between the different containers? Well, you do it with volume. So volume, what is it exactly? When you have a container, you can mount a volume inside a container on a specific point. And it allows you to use a mechanism that is known as copy on write. So copy on write is a very interesting concept in computer science, where you can have a dissociation between the physical storage and the logical storage. let's suppose that you have the same Ubuntu that is used across a bunch of different containers. Logically, they are different volumes, but physically, they are the same. And therefore, to avoid having to duplicate n times the n operating system that you want, you have the copy on write, co for intimate people. So copy on write, what is it exactly? You have a logical volume that is pointing on a physical storage. And when you do a write, it's only when you do a write that you will do a copy. But as long as you don't do a write, as long as you don't modify it and you are only reading it, even if the logical storage is different, the physical one points to the same. And that's why they are blazingly fast. Because even if you create 1,000 containers, if they point to the same physical aspect and they don't modify it, that's the key aspect. If they don't modify it, it will be fast. And so the volume are the persistent layer. So there have been questions about the volume. So now I'm going to talk a little bit more about it. Inside the container, you can bind or mount a volume inside the container. If you write a file to a place that is not managed by a volume, it will go inside the TMPFS. So it means that if the container dies, it's only stored in memory, it's out, you lost it. But if you do a write operation on a file that is mounted through the volume subsystem, Docker will manage this layer for you and will manage it through the copy on write. Copy on write is a technology that exists in a bunch of different file systems. I can cite, for instance, ZFS that existed for a long time and a bunch of other file system formats. So this technology is well known, and Docker put it in profit to have fast read and write that are only costly if you change stuff. Is it clear for the Docker volume? Is it more clear now what is it about and the persistent layer?
So yes, just to clarify, so if I summarize what you said, if I want to share some layer across several containers, I use a common volume. Is it it?
Alors, if you want to share, for instance, if you want to share the same Ubuntu, just build an image with this layer, and that's it. It will be reused for you by Docker. This all of this will be managed for you by Docker. And that's it.
And for my example with the GRE, does it still apply?
It's exactly the same. So you
build part of the image. Okay.
Yeah, you build the image with the GRE that is to your liking. You will have a layer. And then after, when you start two containers with the same base layer, they will point on the same physical storage. And if in container A, you modify something, and in container B, you modify something, then and only then a copy on write will happen to isolate them for good. But as long as you don't modify, it will be the same.
So if I summarize, the volume is not for a system aspect, it's rather to store data.
Yeah, completely. And that's one of the key aspects to understand about container. The container should be stateless. The things that you want to save should be in volume. If stuff that you want to save is not in volume, it's doomed to be lost. It's doomed to be lost. So the volume are only for persisting stuff. And if it's stuff that you don't want to persist, put it inside the image.
Like the it's not only persistent data, because the software is also persistent data. It's persistent data that is not the software.
Yeah, that is not the
definition. That was the point that was not clear to me.
Yeah.
Okay. And if you have two containers that mount, that modify the same file, let's say.
Yeah.
So there will be a copy and write on both sides. So during the execution, it's isolated.
It depends. If the volume is shared, if it's the same volume that is maintained on two points, you will have concurrent access.
Okay. And if there are different volume but pointing to the same file.
Different volume, not really. So if
you have container one with volume one pointing somewhere to some file, and you have container two with volume two pointing to the same file, and they both modify it,
A copy and write will happen.
So a copy and write will happen, And so during the execution, it's essentially isolated. I understand that. But yeah. Is the change persistent after the container close? What will happen?
The volume continue to exist without the container.
Okay.
You can see the volume as a USB key or an external hard drive that the container will try to modify. And once the container is done, it's like removing the hard drive from your computer.
Okay.
So the volume will continue and will persist after the container is dead.
Okay.
Is that clear? Is there other question about volume?
In any case, there won't be any modification in your real file system.
Not that will be persisted.
Okay.
So if you write something on a stuff that is not mounted as a volume, it won't be persisted. It will be in the TMPFS. It will survive as long as the container survives, but as long as the container returns, is stopped or killed, it's gone.
But what I just meant is that if you have your volume that you point to some file on your hard drive, you modify this file,
mm-hmm.
then you close your container and so on.
Yeah.
In your file system, the file hasn't changed.
Mm-hmm.
But if you open the volume again, you have the modified file.
No, the change that you do on the volume will be persisted. They are immediate. The change that you do on the volume are immediate.
But don't have effect on your real file system.
It depends if it's a bind or a mount. If it's a bind, you are sharing the same file hierarchy from your operating system, from the host, inside the container. So if you do one write from the host or one write from the container, it will be persisted because it's virtually the same one. They are bind. But if you do a mount, it's like a USB key that you mount, and you can create as many USB keys as you want.
Okay.
So you have two different verbs, bind and mount, that don't mean exactly the same thing. And all the rest, it will be in TMPFS. Is there other questions?
Yes, I have a question. So in case your program inside the Docker is performing, let's say, an operation with data that needs intermediate values, so like RAM, okay?
Yeah.
How does this work exactly? So... is there any specific allocation for a container or?
The container is a broad term that will contain C groups, but in particular, the container can be restricted as the amount of memory it can use. So when you start a container, it doesn't magically make memory appears on your machine. So you can have restriction on the container. And if you have big data intensive operation that require a lot of memory, the container will work exactly the same way as you would do with your laptop.
Okay. So it will use, let's say, the RAM of the machine where it belongs.
Yeah. It doesn't make a RAM magically appear. So when you have container that is running, you can put a restriction on it. You can put CPU restriction. You can put I/O restriction. You can put memory restriction. So you can have a bunch of restriction that is very wide on a single container in order to avoid your computer to crash the host. That's also all the time the same core objective of container, isolated application to avoid having the host crash.
Okay.
Is that clear?
Yes.
Other questions?
No, I don't have a question, but not on volume anymore. I have a question concerning the isolation. And so for example, if you have two containers, each of them has an OVS, Open vSwitch.
Okay.
That the Open vSwitch has a user space part and kernel part. And so I guess that the user space is isolated within each container, but the kernel part is shared between the two containers.
Yes, so you can have inside the kernel specific drivers, specific module, and specific abilities. For instance, with CUDA, for instance, you can have a driver that is working inside the Linux kernel and that is shared across containers. So it's about the privileges that a given container have to access certain file or not. So this could, I think, happen too with OVS, but I didn't try specifically to do many hardcore open vSwitch configuration with container, but I guess it could happen.
Yeah, so there is there might be some isolation issue in this case.
I'm going to talk about container networking in the upcoming slide, so maybe it will be clearer.
Okay.
So, container networking. So what problem does it solve? Well, the container needs to do I/O. Sometimes when you run a container, you want to ping google.com or you want to fetch an image that is on the network. Containers need to be able to ping other containers that are running locally or remotely. So how do you control what a container can do or cannot do? What are the containers that they can talk to or not? Well, you have different possibilities. The first one is to have a container that is working on the single bridge. So that's the one that are on the left. By default, when you start a container, all the containers are on the same bridge. So all the containers will be able to talk like if they are connected to a big switch to your host and to the other container. By default, it does that. It's easy to understand, simple. The image, the IP of the container will change every time you restart it. You have no IP persistence on it. I insist, you have no IP persistence. If the container dies and is recreated, you will most likely have a different IP. You can have a specific virtual network that you want to attach only several containers to. So that's the setup on the middle. So you will have one container that is a web application, a container two that will be a database application. They will be on the same bridge, only these two, but they will be isolated from others. And finally, you can have like different virtual networks that can communicate inside their own virtual network, but are not by default able to communicate across different virtual networks. So you can have an isolation per container. You can put several containers inside the network, or you can have several networks with several containers, as you like. In case you are lost, you can do Docker network, and it will give you all the verbs that you can do on a specific network resource. You can connect a container to a given network. You can create a network, a delete one, a list of all the networks that you got and inspect them. In conclusion, there is a bunch of things that I want you to keep. Containers are not a hipster technology. A container have been around for a while. Paravirtualization have been around for a while. It's a core need of operating system to be able to isolate application from one another. So the need have been there from the beginning of computer science. It's just one brand, one particular arrangement, but the problem have always been the same. Container are also a way to manage your application deployment. They manage the dependencies. They manage what you can pack inside a given image and how you can run it. And they are fundamental for cloud native operation. Containers are just a building block. On top of it, there is container orchestration. If you like my voice a lot, I can present you what Kubernetes is. It's on YouTube. It's on the Scaleway YouTube channel. And I explain in French or in English all the things that there is to know about container orchestration. And maybe it can help to understand why, what are the needs for orchestrate thousands and thousands of containers that will be born, dead, created, recreated, restarted every time that an application starts or stop or is deployed or a new version is deployed. Containers are just the building blocks, but on top of it, you want to orchestrate them. What is going to be created and when? And this comes later on. So if you want to learn more about container, I got a bunch of slides. So a good person that I like a lot that is called Jérôme Petazzoni have trained people to understand container for more than a decade now, I think, for several years for sure. And he got a website that is completely open that is called container.training, and you have slides that are self-paced. So it means that you have hundreds and hundreds of slides that explain to you stuff about Docker, and you can go through them at your own pace. There is also a bunch of YouTube videos that I've selected for you from YouTubers that I like, and that I explain Docker in more details with more more experience and more command line. So don't hesitate to check them out, but they are 2 hours or 3 hours long. So it's more like a workshop, and I wanted to do a presentation there. And if you have other questions about container, don't hesitate to contact me. So contact me at erleon@scaleway.com. I thank you a lot for your attention. I hope it was informative. And if you have any question, I'm all for it.
Remy, I have a question.
Yeah, go for it.
It's related to write on demand, the techniques that you presented. So in some programs, you want to replace what degree of control do you have on it? Because one simple practical example, so on some programs, you want at all cost to avoid to write gazillions of very small files, especially if you have a SSD. So yeah, you would like to set up a RAM disk in order to write in there, and then only afterwards write the final file to SSD.
Yeah. So
what degree of control do we have with containers?
But you can have the degree that you want as long as you manage your write operation correctly across volume or TMPFS. So if you write a bunch of little small files to TMPFS, it will be fine. Your SSD won't be touched. It will be only the memory of your laptop that will be touched for it. So if you have a bunch of very IO intensive operation with a bunch of files that are created and destroyed very quickly, I would suggest to keep them, to keep this IO out of your volume mount. You can keep them on the container layer that will be short-lived, that is only living in memory. And then when you are satisfied with consolidated files that you want to write and that you got a small amount to write, then you want to move them to volume.
Okay, okay.
But one key aspect of a container to understand is that it's, and that's also one of the key operation, key reason why a cloud operator loves them so much, is because in cloud, you pay for everything. Everything got a cost because we understand the fundamentals. So in case you have specific workflows that are very IO intensive, but you don't want necessarily to persist, keeping them out of your volume is a good strategy that will reduce your cost and improve your performances. So there is a virtuous cycle here. And that's why as a cloud practitioner that I'm here to help you understand those patterns.
All right, thank you.
Other questions?
Yeah, thank you, Remy. I have a question about specific resources like GPUs. How would you share them with containers?
With GPU, you don't necessarily share them. With GPU, what happens is that you will use a GPU just like you would with your laptop. It's the operating system that will manage all this sharing for you. The same way that you can access the microphone, for instance, or you can access the IO, and it's managed for you by the operating system, it's the same with GPU. So with GPU, and in particular NVIDIA and CUDA, you can have them shared across container if you are using the right NVIDIA driver, the right version of the Linux kernel. It's very hot science, as would say Bruno Latour, so it's not very stable, it changed a lot. So I would strongly advise you to keep your kernel up to date and your driver up to date to have the latest feature and the latest pass-through that will allow you to have optimal performances. But basically for GPU, what happens? When you have a GPU on your machine, you have the operating system that is working, and the kernel is accessing the GPU for you. So without going too much inside the detail, it will talk on a PCI Express bus most of the time, and it will write stuff inside a bunch of memory and get back a bunch of memory. Basically, that's how most of the devices such as GPU work. And so from a container perspective, you would use the GPU just like you would if you would not be in a container. That's one of the core benefits of having container is that you use them without thinking about them too much. Then the Docker runtime, the Docker aspect of the operating system will manage the different concurrent access to the same GPU that is coming from the container and from the host as well. That's the job of the operating system.
Okay, thanks. So you basically have the same drawbacks than when you use them outside of container. Like if you having out of memory issues because you have three processes accessing the same GPU, the same would happen with a
container. The container are not magic. They are an isolation mechanism. They are not magic. So if you have containers that are doing stuff that mess up with your GPU in the first place, putting them in container will not solve it. But if you have containers, you can put restriction about what a given container can do in order to not mess what the other container are doing as well. So in case, for instance, where you have a bunch of memory output, you can specify a given container to not use as much GPU memory. And then inside the container, if the software tries to do a write operation on a bunch of memory that exceed its quota, it will be denied. And then you have the guarantee that at least it will not crash the other application. And then you can have quotas about memory that the GPU, about GPU memory that a given container can use.
Thanks, yeah, that's exactly what I wanted, yeah.
Yeah, so take a look at restriction, quotas, capabilities, and GPU quotas with containers. That might be help you to make your system more stable. And in particular, I think that if you load a bunch of stuff inside the GPU without taking too much into account how much your GPU is busy, this can lead to bad outcomes. So I would strongly suggest that you have a much more fine-grained approach to your GPU usage. That way, it's more liquid. If you have a bunch of I/O that is like putting 16 gigabytes inside a single memory, it will overcrowd your GPU for sure. But if you have like small and fine-grained operations that are much more liquid, it's much more also cloud compatible. So in case we have huge GPU that you will not use all for yourself, but you have a bunch of fine-grained operation, as a cost perspective from the cloud practitioner, it's way more cost-effective to have small and fine-grained rather than a huge one. For GPU access memory, of course.
Yeah, in practice, it's not as easy though.
It's not always
doing big models and doing big computations. So.
That's also one of the reasons why sometimes people in the film industry don't necessarily use GPU all the time. Because even if the image they are working on is an image, it's bigger than the amount of memory that is available inside the GPU. And sometimes they just need to have regular memory and they cannot use GPU because GPU are not big enough to fit all the model inside. And sometimes you can split it up and sometimes you can't.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Other questions?
I have a general question concerning security. Is the container in terms of security less secure than VM? Meaning that, for example, there are many issues concerning that the escape, the user in the container can escape from the container and reach the host.
Okay, so security would deserve a complete presentation on its own. For a container perspective.
Just your general opinion.
My general opinion is that containers share the same kernel. So if you have an exploit inside the container that is able to escape the sandbox and that is able to run as root with kernel privileges, you're doomed, period. So there is a bunch of security that could be put in place to ensure that container won't be escaped from, that they run with as little privileges as possible. They exist, and in 99% of the case, they are enough. But in case you have extremely secure deployment, then you would use different kind of virtualization technologies that are just like VM, but lightweight in its way. If you are interested in this kind of isolation, but want to have a VM that start quickly, I would strongly advise you to look at Firecracker. That is a technology coming from our dear friend AWS from Amazon. And that's the runtime that they use for serverless. So in case you want to have the biggest isolation that is possible and on va dire, how can I say it, reutilization from the container side, take a look at Firecracker.
Okay,
it's coded in Rust. It got a lot of hipster people working for it and a $1 billion industry working with it. So it's your best bet today to have this kind of isolation. But what I want to strongly emphasize, container can be extremely secure. If you have a container that is dropping all privileges, running inside the chroot with restriction on CPU, restriction on memory, and restriction on privileges, good luck to escape from it. Basically, you are as good as having an exploit of the kernel in the first place. You have an isolation and a security that is as good as the Linux kernel. That is quite good. So I think from a security perspective, the container mechanisms are quite good. And also, if you have security flaws inside your application, container will not magically solve them.
Okay.